Okay, good morning. First, I want to thank the organizers for Air India for inviting me here. And when I was listening to the other two talks, that's already done, right? Practically done. This is what we are proposing. We have not flight tested. So one of the things I am trying to see is anybody is willing to go for this, to do flight testing. So I just want to give the background first. And this work was done when Pashilkar from NAL, he was a postdoc working with me. Then we started looking at intelligent controllers for flight control. So I'll give the motivation, it will be clear. And this is my student. She finished. So what I'm going to cover is the motivation. Spend some time on that. And because the guidelines are very important. And unfortunately, because we are in the university public domain, so whatever data we could get where we can do this kind of studies, we could get the aircraft model and for auto landing, and then we are trying to work on that. So that we will do that. I will cover the basic very briefly, but mainly my interest is in this. I'll give the idea. Idea is you are coming for landing, right? Suppose you are in auto landing. And when you are going to design, following the glide slope, suddenly the actuator, elevator gets stuck. Can you manage to land safely? Or even for the approach, when you come and make a turn, during the turning, the aileron gets stuck. Actuator failures. This is just a, what you call a scenario to look at the concept. Of course, it can be extended to the other regions of flight. You can have battle damage, 20% of the wing is gone. Can you still manage it? The only problem is, if you have redundant surfaces, enough control authority is available, only the pilot doesn't have the time to react. First of all, he doesn't know what has happened. And even then, you have to operate the other surfaces in unconventional way. Right? So if you can, you have enough control authority, but the pilot did not know, and that is why the time is lost. So the flight is not safe. So if you can quickly help to use the other surfaces in an unconventional way to still get the necessary control moments, at least to make it stable, and ask the question later to whether it can also land safely. Answer is yes. And where is the technology coming from? The neural controllers. Neural controllers has the enormous capacity for learning. So it can learn adaptively, adjust. So you have designed a controller for normal operating condition. If the aircraft is flying, everything is fine. Suddenly something happens, just for argument, the elevator gets stuck, you can't move that, and your dynamics completely changes. How do you manage to land? The neural network, because of its learning capacity, it learns the dynamics of the failed aircraft, and of course, when it does the controller, essentially it is like an inverse controller. So under the inverse, when the plant has failed, if you calculate the inverse, whatever command you can give, the system will follow that. Within the available control limits, whether the neural network is fast, whether it can learn and give the support, essentially pilot is taken off at that time. The neural takes over and controls the whole thing, and then it lands. And since pilot is not involved, that's why we are looking at auto landing. Everything is automatic. Can it do feasibility? Answer is yes. Is it really fast enough to learn the failure? Answer is yes. And the failures cannot be predicted. I can't see neural network. They can use train it for all kind of failures and then put it online. And if the failure happens to be in one of the cases for which you are trained, it can work. But really, we don't know the failure. And the system has to learn online. So in real-time learning, it doesn't know what failure has happened. Can it learn and adapt, still land the aircraft safely? Answer is feasibility we have done. In simulation we have done, we have implemented this neural scheme in a implementation in a DSP or actual hardware, tested. Unfortunately, we have not done a flight test. Unless the flight test is done, it's not. We will not say we are ready. Okay, so we look at the performance based on neural, and then we find there are some neural controllers are very good for learning, adaptation,
And we find even there some gaps in the envelope. Can I use fuzzy for that? Why fuzzy? Fuzzy is very good for approximate reasoning. So when you combine fuzzy and neural, your model is not exact approximate, but still neural is learning as the failure happens. When you combine both and effectively do that, we find the fault tolerance envelope is increased by a great amount. Even the holes in the neural network envelope, fault tolerance envelope is reduced. Fuzzy neuro is a good candidate. Of course, we have not looked whether fuzzy also, when you implement in real time, whether it can do that. That part we have not done that. And that idea mainly is to develop intelligent controllers. Okay. So motivation, there are a number of cases where you have seen a lot of, especially if you watch this air accident investigations, Discovery Channel, there are a number of cases the failure has happened and the pilot somehow manages, and there are a lot of cases later after the flight investigation, you come to know there are NS control authority in different surfaces. If only pilot knew and if he can coordinately activate that, he could have saved the flight. Number of cases like that. So essentially, when you are flying like this, yeah, this is the main thing. Actuator, we are just taking an example for actuators. Failures, mechanical, hydraulic, or electrical. Okay, so what happens then? Basic idea, controller designed at normal condition cannot handle failures. It's not designed for that. Control authority is available, reconfiguring the controllers, right? On real time, online, is very difficult because you need to understand first what is going on and then reconfigure. Okay, and of course you have all kind of things, all of this, the area is intelligent controllers, essentially fault tolerant. Okay, one of the important criteria what we put in is configuration changes without reconfiguring the controller, adaptation, failures, and also environment. Okay, one of the important things we have checked here is when you go through a microburst, very severe wind shear, can it handle? Because a lot of accidents have happened because of wind shear. So I can't predict it. I can't plan for it. The pilot commits in and finally when he touches, he has a problem. So answer is yes, even under a micro. So I'm going to throw in all the thing at that. Failure. Can it handle single failure? Yes. Can it handle double failure? Aileron and elevator together gone at certain points. Can it handle failure? Answer is yes. And can it handle this failure along with the severe wind shear, microburst? Answer is yes. Okay, for landing. Okay, so no, don't believe me. I will put the results. High reliability and robustness. Generalized design methodology that can be applied to different types of aircraft. We have done it for verification and landing because landing is the severest thing. And you can do it in other phases of flight. And if you are talking about fighter aircraft going on a high alpha flight, suddenly the elevator goes off or some surface disappears due to battle damage, all this we can investigate. So essential point, if you want to do this, your control actuator should have redundancy. Very important point. If you have more redundant surfaces and if you can operate them each independently, you are well prepared for any failure. But if you operate them symmetrically, like ailerons go elevators go together and ailerons go in the opposite anti-symmetric way, all that, you cannot handle this kind of thing. So make each surface act separately, independent of others. You had to have a control logic and communication links and all for that. And apart from the current things, they are coming with engines, right? Engines, swivels, thrust vectoring, all that, you know, you design. And if you have, instead of a single tail, you have an inclined tail, you can have two surfaces. If you can operate each one, see the redundancy is built in the configuration design. So one of the important things is sufficient redundancy is available, you can handle faults. Okay? I'm not talking about sensor failures. Sensor failures is a big thing, FDI. You can detect it and take the sensor out and all. More severe is the actuator failure and other type of failure. Okay? Now, very brief review. This is the area we have been working on. I will not touch that because why radial basis function is very amenable for real-time learning. And one of the problem in this, in all these neural networks literature is you should know the at least the dynamics, how many neurons you select for a neural network is a problem. You can't fix it when something happens in failure during flight. So we have to learn that also. This gives a mechanism for learning the architecture or the adapting the size of the neural network as well as the parameters of the neurons online in real time very quickly. That's why we are using that. Okay, we want to not the batch learning is the conventional other way. Sequential learning, this is for real time application. That's what the mechanism for that. I will not go into that. Essentially, one of the problem is how do you select the number of neurons for a network to learn the dynamics, and the dynamics is changing. So essentially, the neurons also will be changing. That's what the brain is doing. When you are very baby young, your number of neurons small. Over a period of time, you develop, right? And also neurons get deleted. If you are not using for a sufficient time, it is deleted. When you see it later, again it builds up. So adaptively varying the network size to account for the approximating the dynamics also is important. All that is possible here. We have done that. So I will not go into that. It's called a minimal resource allocation network. That is the main scheme. So I just want to give the flavor. I will not get into the details. If anybody wants, they can discuss later. So essentially, the idea is you can grow the, it starts with zero neuron and builds the number of neurons depending on what it's trying to approximate. And if you don't add a neuron, you adjust the parameters of the existing neurons to do that thing. And also you check all the time whether you need all these neurons. If some of them are not working for sufficient time, you delete them. That's how the brain is doing that. So put that, why I want to do it in real time, I want the size of the network to be minimal all the time. My overhead, computational overhead is small. And also if something is not being used, why do you carry that overhead all the time? Delete it. And if some new dynamics comes, it will learn and adapt. So essentially I am trying to use a neural network for adaptively learning very quick dynamics. That's the idea. Okay, these are all the equations for that. Now, why motivation for a neurocontroller, right? Severe wind shear, okay? Number of cases, pilot had enough control but could not react fast. During landing, control surface actuator failure is most critical, especially if he commits in auto landing and goes on that. Can existing controllers be modified to overcome the problem? That is a question we ask. Okay, some assumption, criteria. What existing controllers should be retained? So I cannot throw out the existing controller and put my neural controller there. Nobody will touch it. Because that has been proven over a period of years, safety, pedigree, all that. If everything is working normal, I don't want your controller. That is a criteria, right? Neural controller is not an alternate for existing controller. That is first point we put. Second, no offline training, right? So offline training, a lot of applications are there. You train for a different failure scenario, you get a network and put it on. If the failure happens in one of the cases, network will respond correctly. But the real problem is failure you don't know a priori. So it can happen anyway. So even then, can you adapt? So we are looking only for real-time learning, online learning. And failure considered for this case are stuck faults. Okay, just to start, actuator getting stuck, actuator deflection is plus minus 20 degrees. Suddenly at minus 5, it's stuck. The problem is it is not available for control, but not only not available for control, it acts a continuous disturbance for the other systems. It produces a moment which acts as a disturbance moment all the time. And this one is very important point because I don't want to touch the existing controller. So the neural network will come on top of that as a supervisory controller. This is what we do. Controller has basic mechanism. The brain is the top, right? So neural, it's a like a hierarchical controller. Neural network is learning all the time. If there is no failure, it just learns. That's all. It sits in the background. The controller, conventional controllers doing all the job. And if there is no failure, everything is fine. Suddenly, if there is a failure, what happens with the conventional controllers? They are not designed to account for failures. So they cannot manage the system, and that is reflected on the error. Suppose you give a command for a trajectory following in landing, and if there is a failure in the system during landing, the conventional controllers cannot control that. It's not designed for the failed plan. So the error, tracking error, will become large. So the neural network will learn or monitoring the error. If the error becomes large, neural control will come and it operates the other surfaces in an unconventional way and pumps in the control signals. And essentially, it is a neural aided basic control scheme. And the aiding part will come when the system is not able to handle normally. This is a very big mechanism in robotics. This is what is called feedback error learning. So a normal condition, nothing will happen. It is sitting at the supervisory role, monitoring all the inputs and outputs, and it is learning all the time the dynamics. If suddenly there is a failure, conventional controller cannot handle it. The neural network has learned the failed plan, and it's giving appropriate commands to control so that even after the failure, you can follow the trajectory as close as possible within the control limits, all within the limits. That's the idea. A simple example for your feedback error learning is like when you are learning driving. If you are a driver and your instructor is sitting next to you, you are going on the road. So long as you are driving, this fellow is sitting quietly and watching you. And if you make any, what do you call, wrong moves, you go too close to something or suddenly he comes and interacts and corrects it, okay, if he has a control, he can do it. But if he, normally he comes and puts your steering out the other way, and once you are in the normal path, he goes off. But he is watching you all the time. Remember that. So that is the idea here. So I am going to put a neural controller on top of existing controllers. If everything is normal, neural controller is learning, and that's all. If there is a failure, it is learning all the time, so it learns the fail plan, and it gives an appropriate correction. Simple example. Right elevator gets stuck at 10 degrees. You have left elevator, right aileron, left aileron. Can you combine the other three surfaces in a different way to produce enough moments to balance this and land? That is the question. So in the only problem is if the pilot knows what has failed, and if he knows what is the corrective action he can take, and then if he can operate that within the short time, it can be done. But normally, the pilot doesn't have very quick reaction time to do this kind of things because the time available is small, whereas that is why the neural network is able to do it faster. That's the idea. Okay, this is the basic reference for adaptive neural controller. This comes from feedback error learning, mainly used heavily in robotics. This is the diagram. It's not clear. I will show it here. This is a nonlinear system. Actually, the plant can be full nonlinear. This is a conventional controller. This is a basic control loop. Forget about this. Now, if everything is normal, this can be your standard design. You can do LQG design, PID design, whatever it is. You give a trajectory command, the system follows, all that is okay. The neural controller comes here. It takes the same input, actually the same outputs also, desired commands. It is monitoring the error. I have not put that. This is information monitoring. So this error is monitored, and the neural controller produces output based on the error. So long as this loop is going on normal, the error will be very small. So this will not produce any output to control here. If the plant is failed, suddenly it fails, the controller is not designed for that. So controller trying to correct a failed plant, the error will be large, and the error is being monitored, and neural controller will pump in neural control signals. Essentially, the loop will become like that. Not under failure, this will be like that. The sharing is in real-time basis, and if it is able to nullify the error, again the conventional will be. That's the idea. So under normal condition, this is just learning. Nothing is touching. So that is one of the criteria we put, because existing controllers have been well designed, well proven in flight, so don't want to touch that. I can put a neural controller here, but nobody will buy. What is the proof? Whether it will work for all conditions, all that, right? So this is the only part, and this is very important part. So we are just sitting here, and if there is a failure, it will inject, otherwise it will not. And it is based on the error, and it is not a priori fixed time. Real time, based on the error, error is the indication that conventional controllers are not able to follow the control the aircraft. That's the idea. Okay, so actual thing is put here. The, you can see this is a trajectory generating command for if you are following the glide slope and all, auto landing. This is the conventional controllers and all. So it is taking the same inputs and same outputs, neural controller, and giving a corrective signal. And the main thing for neural updating is the error. This is a standard thing. Okay, we don't have a model, right? We used an aircraft which is similar to F-16. The data was available in the public domain. So essentially it has two elevators, two ailerons. We had to do some messaging there because we want to operate each one as independent, right? So we had to split the data with a CFD, modify that so each surface can be independently operated. And then, of course, there is a radar is only one. We don't have redundancy. So radar failure we cannot handle. So what we can handle is failure of ailerons and elevators. And we took landing in the, okay, it will come. This is a standard NASA TP for which we have the data. We have done all that, right? So symmetric parts, everything can be split into operating as individual actuator surface. Okay? So we have done that and correspondingly modified the aerodynamic coefficients to account for that. So that is why we are doing that in the public domain. Okay, these are all standard aircraft nonlinear equations. You can see 6 degrees of freedom and also all the parameters we have used this as it is. The plant is nonlinear. Okay, the trajectory for auto landing is, I don't know whether you can see it. You come from here and make a right turn and then you capture the glide slope 1, glide slope 2, and then you hit the thing and flare. So there are 6 segments. The thing is given, this is a typical. So the essential point is when you come here and lock on, the trajectory is completely followed. And during the trajectory, failure can happen. The failure for turning is aileron failure. Failure during descent is elevator failure. Single elevator failure, right elevator failure, left. Or then I'm going to throw right aileron, left elevator. Can I manage it? All that kind of thing during this entire phase. It can happen randomly. It can failure can happen anytime. That's also not fixed. And actually, the way we have done the simulation is failure as most difficult time. That means when you are about to turn, aileron fails. When you are about to descend, elevator fails. What can you do? Okay. And the specification for touchdown. This is what we call as touchdown pillbox. In the longitudinal direction, in the center of the runway. It should be minus 100 plus 300. Within that, it's a rectangular pillbox. And lateral is
5 meters.
So you can put a rectangle and the center line of the runway. You should land within that. And sink rate, all these conditions are there, right? Sink rate, main wheel should touch down before nose wheel. Touchdown velocity should be greater than 60. Bank angle is less than 10 degrees. Otherwise, your tip will graze the ground. So these are all standard conditions. And under failure, when I am trying to control with neural, do I need all this? That is the question. Okay, and wind profile, again, I said this is a turbulence profile, but we throw in the microburst. You can see this is a wind shear, severest wind shear. Can I still manage that? Okay, now the failures, you can see elevator alone, failure, aileron alone, which is single failure. Type 2. Left elevator, elevator and aileron. Of course, you can have different combinations you can run through. Okay. So, of course, this is a conventional design. I will not touch that. This is well, everybody, that's a normal design. So, for longitudinal control, right? So, you can see these are the two commands and the controls available. I mean, available are elevator right, elevator left, and throttle. And it controls all these variables, longitudinal variables. Similarly, for lateral, you have the two, three controllers are this, right? What is that? Rudder, right aileron, left aileron, and it's controlling the roll rate, yaw rate, all that. This is standard. So this is the profile. Now you can see here, this is where the different segments are there, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So this is altitude. You are coming here and then glide slope, the severe winds, no failure, baseline, the conventional existing controllers. Now, this is the velocity, this is the, I can't see this. This is the, what is it, y direction. You can see it comes like this and then lands. And this is beta, side slip angle, beta. Now you can see this here, this is the peak is due to that shear. So normal case, everything is fine, right? So you can see the notation here. BTFC is the baseline trajectory following controller. That means it's the conventional controller is doing the job and the reference is given by green. So I want to follow that. Everything is fine. Severe winds, but no failure. Okay. Now, if I do a failure, let me go to the other case. Where is the, this is a failure, just to illustrate. Baseline and what failure, I think it is an elevator failure. You can see what happens here. It is trying to come, elevator gets stuck. It is not able to, the altitude goes off. Again, the velocity goes off here. Okay, now if you see this, that is the BTFC alone. Let me go to the other one. See, this is the case, right? Now you see what we have done here is, I have trimmed all the control moment requirements and see what is the maximum I can allow for control under failure. So this envelope is based on the trimming conditions. That is the maximum you can do. Because the existing control surfaces can provide a moment only up to that. Now the figure is, this is the elevator, right? Left elevator, it goes to minus 20 to plus 20. The region is, you can see here, you can go up to minus 18 to plus 22. Okay? Now the existing controller, okay, elevator, baseline controller, how much capacity it has for failure? It can tolerate from here to here. And there are a lot of cases where the existing, depending on the failure, existing controllers cannot handle any failure at all in certain, like ailerons and elevators and all. But in this case, it can for left elevator, one sample we have given. So my idea is, if the existing controllers doesn't have any curve like that, with the neural controller, can I put that? And another question, if I put a neural controller on this, can I enlarge this to this level? I can tolerate more failures. That is a question. Okay? Of course, the control strategy and all the same diagram, it's sitting on here. I implemented the neural network, how the this is actual the signal flow, how it is done in the simulation in the real thing also you will do like that. This is the result. Okay? Now you can see here, BTFC, the blue one is not able to do that, whereas BTFC plus neural network combined together, we have that result. It's able to control that. So it is learning the thing, and then how does it do? These are all the signals. This is the neural network is learning and building the network. And you can see here, suddenly one elevator comes and stuck here. The other elevators and the other ailerons in a different combination is being guided by the neural network controller to meet the requirement of this. So you can see all the control signals, how it is working within the capacity. It is learning. This is the learning of the neural network, number of neurons. So adaptively, it learns very quickly the failure. Essentially, what a neural network does is it tries to learn the inverse of the plant. Once it gets the inverse, whatever you give the command, that will be followed in the output. So that is what it is trying to do. And it is able to do that within the quick. The question here is, if a failure happens, can it learn quickly and try to adapt? You can see that it is doing that very well. Okay, so this is a basic idea. You can go into details, all of that is available. And this is what I said, elevator alone failure. Okay, you can see here, elevator failure, this is a trim limit. See, whatever you do, you can do only within that. That is only you have the existing control moments available. Single elevator failure, there is nothing, no failure can be tolerated. If I put neural network, I can get this. Out of this, I can get this. But again, take a look at this. There is a gap here. There is a gap here. There is a gap here. So essentially, at those gaps, what does it mean is, it's still landing, but it is not meeting the lateral specifications of 5 meter. But still, we want to put the same thing,
Now these are the holes in that neural thing, right, to meet the exact specification.
That is where the logic of using fuzzy comes. If there are certain holes doesn't meet the specification, because if I use the fuzzy using the approximate reasoning concept, can I fill these gaps? Answer is yes. But of course the overhead will be more. But essentially, when you can't tolerate any failure with conventional controller existing, well-designed controllers, you can achieve up to this within the total available envelope of this with your neural-aided controller for elevator. Is it time?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I think I can. Now you can just take 1 or 2 minutes. Just okay. Similarly, for only one. This is combined. Left aileron, left elevator. Right? You can see. This is the envelope within which you can operate for the failure. What the neural network, where is this? BTFC plus neural network, this is the envelope you can cover. This is only the conventional controller. Conventional, actually you can define a ratio, area of this region divided by the total area. That is the fault tolerance envelope. You can enlarge this by a large amount. Okay, I think I will leave it here. Fuzzy, I will skip it. You can see similar things. I will go to the conclusion and close. Yeah. Intelligent controller applications, nonlinear dynamics with large uncertainty, also severe wind shear, normal performance of the system when normal operation is there, comes into play when the system deviating from the nominal. And pilot does not have time to react, very quickly it can adapt. Okay, there are no gaps when you use fuzzy, that's all. Okay, the papers are appearing in this, you can check. And of course we want to check it in a flight test. We have not done that. Okay, thank you, I will stop here. Any questions?
I think we are running very late.
Yeah.
May I request all the person who are interested in asking questions, because it's a highly debatable topic, a lot of questions will certainly be there. I request all of you to interact with Dr. Sundarajan during the tea session, please.
Yeah, please.
May I request the...
Just one question. Please.
Hello. I am Group Captain Guratia from the Indian Air Force. Whenever your project reaches to the stage of flight testing, I have two just suggestions, very small ones. I will take very less time. First point, you have discussed about removing the neurons which are not being utilized from the controller, whenever, you know, they are not being utilized for a period of time. But this kind of thing we don't do it in aviation. Because of the compromise which you are making, because of, you know, less memory space or computation power, since I am giving such a big authority to my neural controller to override the primary flight control system, now I cannot have a situation where because of computation power or because of memory space, I am removing that neuron. It could be utilized, not probably in 100 hours. 101 hour, its experience could be utilized. So please do not do that.
Can I answer that?
Yeah.
Okay. Normally, see, we don't use the neural controller normal operating condition. Condition number one. When there is a failure, what the neural network does is only grows the neuron. It doesn't delete. It doesn't have time. Very quickly, it has to learn. But I take your point that even if it has learned, it should not delete. That is easy to put. But only the thing is computational overhead we have to keep in mind. Yeah.
Second point I have is regarding learning curve again. Like, I understand what you're working on a single platform. Your neural controller is learning from a single platform. But in aviation, we don't do it like this. We learn from other platforms also and from other experience also. So in your neural controller, there should be a module which should have a capability of learning from other platforms also and others' experiences also.
Sure. Can I answer that?
Yeah.
So, sure, I fully accept that. Neural network is ideal for training based on other scenarios. So, here I am saying the condition that if it falls within that, I can use it. But if it doesn't fall, what happens? So, that is why I am saying I should learn online. But I can store it with enough experience from other aircrafts, other flight, other failures. Can knowledge be can be stored a priori in the neural to start with? That is not a problem. Right. We have not done that. That's all.
My suggestions were only when you reach a flight testing stage, these would be very important issues.
No,
probably to be designed in the program itself from the beginning.
No, no. We are an academic institution. This is hypothetical. We fly. We see what I want to say. First of all, whether it will work. We found it can work. Can I go for implementation real time with software and all? We have done it. It goes. We wanted a platform to test. We are looking for partners, actually. Nobody want who will fly this? Tell me. So at least a small one at UAV. Okay, this work was supported by DSO Singapore also. They have taken it and modified that and using.
So we can help you in that, sir.
That's what we are talking to ADE on that. Sure. So hopefully, I fully agree, unless you fly it, nothing can be said. But there is a possibility you can manage. That's all we want to say. And thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Thank Dr. Sundararajan for his excellent presentation on Eurocontrollers.